for your first performance. When you go out the door, guys, just latch them behind you and don't keep them open too long. That way their cabin stays nice and cold, colder than it is hopefully now, if you want to go out. Awesome. If you happen to feel sick, because we do have a bit of mission, I highly recommend to go outside. That doesn't mean you can't see anything. I did take a peek outside. You get to see some coral, you can see some fish even. And you might even see a sea turtle or something if you look out the window. So if you feel sick, don't feel bad about going outside. You still have plenty of opportunity to see things, guys. Also, you'll still be able to hear me. That said, feel free to stay in here. I just know there's a bit of motion today, guys. With that, I'll go ahead and start my tour, guys. I'm going to tell you a little bit about where we are, what you're seeing today, and what this ecosystem like down here. One thing I forgot to mention, if you are feeling sick, guys, look out to the horizon. That's where the ocean meets the sky as far as you can. Relax, take a deep breath. Do not stare at the waves. If you stare at the waves, guys, it's going to make it 10 times worse. Also, do not go in our bathrooms. That's an enclosed area, and then it makes it 1,000 times worse, guys. Also, please let one of the crew know that you are feeling sick. We'll help you out the best we can, guys. With that, you are seeing through a quarter and an inch plexiglass. That is a different type of glass than what is up here on our windows. But it's not tinted and it is not colored. It's the same thing as if you were snorkeling, guys. So if you get the opportunity today to see into the ocean without having to get wet. You might be wondering where we brought you out to, guys. And that is a location known as Eastern Dry Rocks. It's known as Eastern Dry Rocks because when we were first coming out here, guys, the sailors were sailing and they were naming things. Oh, they noticed a pile of dry rocks. It was most likely at low tide. But if you take a look, you might see some waves white capping. That's not due to the roughness, that's due to actual reef. And it's also right there where that hole is. If you can see it, it's kind of hard to see. That's actually the location known as the Eastern Dry Rocks. And that's where, at low tide, pieces of the reef, the coral heads, will actually be above the water. And they'll start to dry out. They actually appear as dry rocks. That's why it's called Eastern Dry Rocks. It's called Eastern because we're on the eastern end. It also happens on the western end, which is on the other side of that iron structure. Couple of people have some guesses as to what that iron structure is. And some people think it's something to do with the oil industry. It is not. It is due to lighthouses. Here in the east, we used to have white ships where we would hang a lantern up in the mast and signal people that, hey, don't come any closer. This is near a shallow area, so they wouldn't run aground. And that went away because we learned we could actually build a structure out there. That's built on an area known as Sand Key. The lighthouse itself is Sand Key for Lighthouse. We named things super common. That was an area that had a lot of sand back in the day. And unfortunately, the first lighthouse they built was built using brick and mortar. And well, I didn't agree with where it was built. We had the first hurricane come through after it was built, which was 17 years after it was built. And I wiped that structure away and most of the sand, and then they rebuilt it using that kind of conical structure, guys. We have six of those up and down the keys. And a little bit of a fun fact is the guy that designed the Eiffel Tower also helped in designing our lighthouses here in the keys. And there's six of them, 30 miles apart. They're designed so that way when you lose sight of one, you can gain sight of the other. Depending on how tall that mast is, the horizon can be anywhere from 10 to 15 miles. So, the way of allowing mariners, when we didn't have GPS and depth finding, to get in and out of here or up and down the key safely. That said, we still have people running around today. But, enough about that. We took you 6.2 miles south to this location. Does anyone know what is further south is? Anyone know? Cuba? I'm hearing something. Cuba is correct. It's another 84 miles south. We're not going there today, guys. It's a different trip. We're just going to hang out here and turn around and go back. But just to put that in perspective, guys, if you drove down, you're going to need to drive come back. Quite a nice drive. I get a quite a bit of a juicy view, but you drive probably 150 miles south of Florida City. That's really the first city you come to when you hit Florida. And we then took you an additional 6 miles, and that's probably about 150 miles out in the Atlantic. That's a really nice sized pufferfish, guys, that green and red one. Anyway, we took out another 150 miles south into the Atlantic Ocean. And if you take that, you think, or say a cruise, and you go 150 miles out into the Atlantic, it's almost guaranteed not to be this calm. This is a great day to be out here. It's going to be a good day to come out. No, it's not that deep at all. If I fish for miles and miles, at least 6 miles, it does get kind of deep where we were coming out at about 30 to 40 feet in some locations. But where we're at now, we're at around 10 to 15 feet of depth. That is because our glass goes about 4 feet under where the wave is, or the ocean is, guys. So we, once our guys, we get a nice look, so we take out 6 to 10 feet from that. And visibility is quite nice today. As you can see, you can actually see outside the window and our glass. And the waves aren't that bad. There is some motion today. But anywhere else, you could go 150 miles out into the ocean, guys. And that's just horrible conditions. A lot worse than these, even on calm days. That said, though, you're probably tired of hearing about where we are. I'm going to talk a little bit about what you're seeing under that glass, guys. You're seeing all kinds of things. We saw a parrotfish over there. You're seeing some yellowtail snapper right now. I know we are seeing some coral rubble and the results of mistreating our reef right now. There's not a lot of coral on this side. We'll get back and y'all be able to see some more coral. Same thing on this side. Yellowtail snapper and then that coral rubble. That coral rubble, guys, is remnants of our staghorn population here in the Keys. We have two kinds of coral, general categories anyway. It's hard coral and soft coral. That hard coral, guys, I'll point it out when I see it. It's going to be that yellow colored rock down there. There's some right there, guys. And it doesn't just come in yellow, it comes in browns and reds. All kinds of colors, common to our coral reef, which isn't a lot. We have the soft coral as well. Those are the ones waving around in the reeds. We have some sea fans and sea queens that are right there coming up, guys. Also some sea fingers, sea rods, sea whips, all kinds of things. And then that hard coral, we have a couple. We have brain coral, which looks just like a cantaloupe, or the brain. I think it looks more like a cantaloupe, or a maze. It really is your print maze. If I see it, I'll point it out, guys. We also have that border coral, which is what you're seeing, that yellow stuff down there. It's called Orbicella annularis, or Varanus varanus, the two most common ones here on the reef. I do apologize. I know the scientific name for sure of the coral. Common name, not so much. I go to college, so they make me remember the scientific name. I don't care about the common name, so that's why. But we have the branching coral as well. You might not see that branching coral today, and that is due to it being almost extinct here in the Keys. The populations you do see, if you're ever snorkeling and see that kind of branching coral, we have two kinds, I'll mention them in a second. That's due to replanting here in the Keys. It's one of our major initiatives in trying to restore our reefs down here. But we have two kinds, staghorn and elkhorn. Staghorn looks like deer antlers, the elkhorn look like elk antlers. And the bone and bramble bush format, well, the staghorn bone, okay? Complex structure. And they provide a lot of rugosity or structure to our reef. And that in turn gives the fish a lot of structure. So if you have a lot of staghorn or a high rugosity area or highly structured, where there's lots of cracks and crevices, guys, there's going to be way more fish there. Both small fish and big fish, because it helps sustain that food chain, guys. And fish absolutely love structure. Without our reef, guys, they would not be here. Most of them wouldn't even exist, and those that do, they would have a really hard time getting away from predators and finding food sources, just because without the reef, guys, our oceans would be pretty bare. We wouldn't have anything kind of structure. The only structure you'd have would be a hydrothermal vent, which is not anything realistic to go with food chain off of, or for us to sustain life off of. The fish here on our reef, guys, is responsible for about 70% of our fish that we eat on land have visited or used the reef at least once in their life cycle. Either as larval settlement, adult, juvenile, whatever. A lot of our fish frequent our reef, guys. I'll get to the fish ponds in a minute, guys. But what makes our reef special, what actually allows these reefs to form, guys, is a thing called coral. I know most of you probably have heard about coral, so I hear this in the reef. And the way coral grows, guys, coral is made up of coral. It's a disease here in our ecosystem, especially coral. It's easily transferable. So we don't want you touching our coral down here. If y'all been swimming or snorkeling, have y'all heard of that? But it's due to a variety of reasons, and one of them is because when you touch the coral, guys, the whole colony is covered by a mucus slime layer. It's not just called the polyp, but an entire colony. So there's no way to contain that in that colony. And when you touch it, you're going to wipe away part of that slime. Then they have to get energy to redo that slime that you wiped away. And you don't only just do that, you also leave a bacteria behind. And when you leave that bacteria behind, guys, the coral absolutely hate it. And it's going to start a disease or make it super susceptible to diseases. And diseases on our reef, guys, spread from coral colony to colony very quickly, especially in high-dense areas. That's what happened to our stackhole coral. All those bones or sticks that you see down there, that's what happened. We had whitepox disease come through. And we had our reef.